on, Lakers Nation. Welcome in. Trevor Lane here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. It's Monday night. That means it's time to talk a little Lakers basketball. We're going to talk about LeBron James, his contract extension, what could be going on with that. Remember, that date when he can sign a contract extension coming up August 4th. Not a deadline by any means. It's actually the first day he can sign it, but could be an important date for the Lakers. We'll talk a bit about that. We'll talk about the trade front, what's going on there, this situation that just continues to drag on. Joining me tonight to kick things off, we've got Matt the Optimist Peralta. Matt, how are you doing, man?
Good, Trevor. I've actually got some good news for you. Ready?
Yeah.
Well, I have a source that has three PS5s for sale. If you or someone else is interested, let me know.
What do you think that was all about from Jeannie?
The PS5s?
Yeah.
I'm like 100% sure she was hacked.
That seems like it. That certainly seems like it, doesn't it? That's terrible. I hope that's not what happened, but it definitely seems like what is going on there. But it was a weird tweet. But again, it's Jeannie, so.
She's 0-2 on tweets this summer.
Yeah, right? I think she is.
I think so.
I have to imagine she was probably hacked on that one, though. But, Matt, I'm at a point where I'm feeling a little bit jealous of the NFL. I talked about this a little bit with Keith. I'm feeling jealous of MLB. Like, there's tons of stuff going on in those leagues right now. And in the NBA, we've got no progress on a Donovan Mitchell deal, no progress on a Kevin Durant deal. The Nets are reportedly still holding out hope that somehow, some way, they can convince Kevin Durant to stick around. We've got no progress yet on a Russell Westbrook trade. Everybody's just sitting around staring at each other. And yet we've got fireworks elsewhere. We've got stuff coming out of NFL training camp. We've got trades taking place in Major League Baseball. We're on pins and needles waiting to see what the Dodgers are going to do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm feeling a little bit jealous. And that's rare because the NBA offseason in general is incredible.
Yeah.
But we've hit that point where I'm looking around going, man, that's looking pretty good right now over there.
Well, you know, the optimistic point of view here, living up to the nickname, of course, is that because the trades have stalled out, it's given us stuff to talk about all the way until the end of August, because this is usually about the dead period for the NBA offseason. Mm-hmm. Generally, we see all the action happen within the first couple weeks of July, and then it's just radio silence until training camp. But look at us. We still get to talk about, will Sean Marks decide to finally let go of Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant? Will the New York Knicks pony up for Donovan Mitchell? Mm-hmm. What's going on in Indiana with Buddy Hield and Miles Turner? So you can look at it that way.
Will these other teams figure out life?
Yes, exactly. But we did record a podcast yesterday, and I kind of echoed the same kind of feelings you have. It's fun that, you know, we've got NFL training camp starting up. Mm-hmm. We've got football now all the way until basically February now, which is awesome. Baseball, trade deadline's heating up. That's until tomorrow, 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Our sister side of Dodger Blue has been incredibly busy covering all the trade rumors because the Dodgers are just linked to literally every player. So that's fun. And then there's the Lakers continually being used in trade talks as leverage.
And here's the thing, like we're kind of waiting for all these other teams to figure things out. It's like every team is dependent upon the something else happening with someone else, right? They're all waiting for a domino to fall, but every domino is dependent upon another one to actually take place. So it's a situation where they're stuck. It really needs a deadline. It needs something to happen. And maybe the LeBron James contract extension date is something that can be some kind of catalyst for positive or for negative. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's going to set the entire trade market ablaze, but we'll talk a little bit about that. Joining us now, we've got Sean Spaces Davis. Sean, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right. Literally feel like I just got off a plane an hour ago, and now I'm here with you guys.
I was going to say, welcome back from Chicago, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Dedicated to the job. Love it.
That's right. Welcome in. I've got people in the chat that are frustrated that there's not new news, and they're upset with us. Hold up. Let me call Rob Pelinka right now and tell him to do something. Let me fix that for you guys. No problem. I can easily solve this. Easy. No problem, everybody.
We've got to call. We've got to call the Knicks. We've got to call the Raptors. We've got to call every other team. Can you guys overpay for Kevin Durant now so we can get on with the rest of our offseason?
Right.
That's the move.
That's really that probably is the biggest domino. Like if that were to, that's the one thing where if that happened, I think everything else would start to fall into place.
Mm-hmm. Holding pattern. Mm-hmm. Fun times.
Yep. Bronny Braun said, if the Pistons didn't use up their salary cap and said they would take Russ for only one first, who would you guys want back? Well, I mean, but they did. So I haven't even been looking at the Pistons as a possibility because they did use up their cap space. So I can't even say who's on the Pistons that you necessarily target because they have a lot of younger guys that they're trying to build around moving forward.
Yeah, they don't have a lot of movable salaries.
Yeah.
Would you want Alec Burks and Nerlens Noel and I guess Kemba Walker that the Knicks dumped on them on draft night?
Probably not.
Kelly Olynyk.
Yeah.
That's what you're looking at.
That's what you're looking at. That's pretty underwhelming.
So I guess the answer is nothing.
Yeah. Not much there. By the way, quick programming note before I forget to mention this. So now that we are into August, this is typically the slow period for the NBA. Usually we get, sometimes it's even as long as like an 8-week stretch from like the middle towards end of July all the way into the mid-September. But we did have quite a bit going on for a decent chunk of July. But what we're going to do is for the month of August and probably the first couple weeks of September as well, up until the point where we start getting guys start coming back into training camp and stuff, we're going to go, instead of being 5, sometimes 6 days a week for the podcast, we're going to go to 3 days a week. We're still going to do our live shows. It's going to be Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Okay, so we're still going to have Mondays and Wednesdays at 9 o'clock Pacific time. We'll have fun Fridays at 2 o'clock Pacific time. Still going to have those, but that's going to be it for the podcast. We're not going to have the Tuesday show in there or the show that publishes that we record on Tuesday anyway or the Thursday record show either. So again, we'll go down to 3 shows a week for the month of August and probably a little bit into September with the caveat that, of course, if something happens, something like a Russell Westbrook trade happens and we're not scheduled to record a podcast that day, we're recording a podcast. Like that's going to happen. But just wanted to let everybody know out there, that's the plan moving forward here for the next probably 6 weeks or so. And then once the season starts getting up and going, once we get to training camp and all that, we'll go back to being 5 days a week.
Sounds good. Let's hope for a Russell Westbrook trade then, shall we?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Senpai NFT said, thoughts on LeBron's desire to stay in LA. As a LeBron fan, I personally think it's smoke, trying to get LA to make a move and stop being chicken. But that's just it, right? Like, what's the ideal outcome? The ideal outcome has to be for the Lakers, what, Thursday, August 4th, shows up and we get an announcement, maybe even before, because, you know, these things get out early, that LeBron's going to sign an extension with the Lakers, right? That's the ideal situation for the club.
Yeah, I think we would all want LeBron to commit past the season with the Lakers. I also think that if he does end up re-signing, that kills some of the leverage that other teams might be trying to extract from the Lakers in any trade talks. So, yeah, that's absolutely the best outcome, is keeping your best player past this current season.
Yeah. And I buy it too. I buy the whole rumors that like he really does want to stay in LA outside of Bronny potentially getting drafted elsewhere. So I buy it.
So desire to stay in LA. I don't know if that's desire to stay in LA. If they do something, if they do X, Y, and Z, if they're able to bring in a certain player or players, or desire to stay in LA as in, look, you don't really have to worry too much about him leaving until Bronny comes into the NBA. At that point, he's probably going to go wherever Bronny plays. And that's basically what he's told us. He's overtly said that. I mean, just outwardly said, yeah, money doesn't matter. I want to go play with my son. And I don't fault him for that at all. That would be an incredible experience. So, I mean, I think for the Lakers, the most likely scenario that I see, regardless of what happens with this extension, is there's 2 more years of LeBron in Los Angeles.
I think so too. Not even me being an optimist. I just genuinely think that LeBron has no reason to leave the Lakers. All his off-court endeavors are here also. That's another factor here as well. His family loves living in Los Angeles by all accounts. Just makes sense.
So if that's what we see take place, what does that do to the trade market? Because I know, you know, the Nets, the Pacers, all these teams, they're waiting for Thursday and they're hoping that LeBron will not sign that extension and that word will get out that LeBron will only sign the extension if the roster is improved. If that doesn't happen, does the trade market move?
Slightly, not enough to where like it becomes one less first round draft pick or the Lakers get another asset in the deal. I think it'll help the Lakers, but not drastically personally.
It gives them more leverage in talks, right? It has to.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of people have been speculating that the Lakers need to do something for LeBron to re-sign if he just ends up re-signing outright, regardless. That hypothetical or that situation is out the window. And so really at that point, you're just negotiating against the market for the players that they want.
From LeBron's side, should LeBron do that? Is that in his best interest to say, Rob, Jeannie, I trust you guys are going to do the things you need to do. Here you go. I'm signing this extension right now. Is that the best thing for LeBron James to do?
It depends. I feel like if LeBron's priority really is winning and helping drive, you know, someone like Kyrie Irving to the Lakers, then yes, because let's face it, if they get to trade for the guy that they've been angling for this entire time, that helps out LeBron's chances of winning. So therefore, yeah, I think so. But there's the flip side here is that maybe he's not confident and so he wants to wait and see. So from that perspective, I can see him waiting, but I ultimately think it would be better for him just to resign. Cause then you also don't get this question hanging over him and the rest of the team in training camp. Like, are you going to resign? Yeah. You know, that's a situation that they probably want to avoid too.
Do you think it happens sooner rather than later? Or do you think he's going to pull the waiting game, Matt?
Knowing LeBron, man, I feel like he's probably going to wait, but I really hope he doesn't for my sanity.
I think like the worst case scenario from a Lakers PR perspective is you go into training camp with Russell Westbrook to media day with Russell Westbrook in a Lakers jersey and LeBron James without an extension signed. That's a nightmare, right? And then throughout the season, we're going to be talking about Russell Westbrook trade rumors because they're going to be trying to move him all the way up until the trade deadline. And throughout the season, we're going to be talking about whether or not LeBron will sign that extension, which he can sign at any point as soon as he chooses during the entire season. He could wake up on a random day in February and go, you know what? I'm going to sign an extension today and sign it. And we have no idea of knowing when or if it's going to happen. That would be a nightmare for the Lakers because they'd be fielding those questions all year long.
Not only do they get to field them, so do we.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's true. Alan, has being a dad made you love sports more? Kevin Durant, does he win another chip or request another trade with his first? Sean, as the senior member of our crew here, I'll ask you, has being a dad made you love sports more?
Yeah, you know, I just turned 45. Thanks, Trevor, for spoiling it for everybody. And yeah, man, it's awesome. The reason why I chuckled is because that was the name of my space last night. So, or we talked about it, rather. I think he honestly requested another trade before he wins another title, personally.
Damn.
Yeah. I mean, it depends on where he ultimately lands, but
same.
I mean, I understand why teams, what we've heard is that teams are worried about Kevin Durant, if he's been upset pretty much everywhere he's gone, even ideal situations like Golden State, the Nets gave him the keys to the kingdom, and he's still not happy, what's to say he's not going to do the same thing to another franchise? So I understand teams being concerned about that. And with that being the pattern, I could say he probably requests a trade first. Has being a dad made you love sports more? I can't say that it's made me love sports more. It's a different lens to look at things through. At times, particularly like when my daughter is participating in sports and I'm out there coaching soccer and stuff like that. But I can't necessarily say that it's like made me enjoy watching a Lakers game more than it did before. Maybe when she gets a little bit older and she's more like watching games with me. Right now, she's still distracted by, you know, Paw Patrol and all that kind of stuff. So
makes sense. What let me throw this question to you guys. What team does Kevin Durant need to get traded to for him to win a ring as soon as possible?
Golden State.
Okay. Of the teams that are realistically anchored to
him. No, I think he could win one if he went to Phoenix. I think that's possible. That's not obviously what Lakers fans want to see, but I think he could win one in Phoenix. I think he could win one in Toronto. I don't think anybody's trading for him if they don't feel like they can win a championship with him.
Sure. That's fair. I'm surprised he didn't bring up Boston.
Yeah, well, I'm just trying to not speak that into existence.
Smart man.
Fair enough. Good point. There we go.
Fair enough. There we go.
Joshua Rouse said, do you think Randall could happen? If it does, I'm convinced Bron and AD have full circled into ruining the franchise for the next 5 years minimum. If LeBron and AD push for Randall and that blows up the same way that Russell Westbrook blew up, and like Ron Gutterman has been calling him in our group chat, Randall is big Russell Westbrook in terms of shooting percentages and all that. That would be like people have said LeBron has destroyed franchises on his way out the door because of how many picks and stuff they've had to surrender. That would be pretty destructive if you got Randall and then he didn't work to the same degree that Russell Westbrook didn't work. And I'm not saying that's for sure what would happen, but I'm saying if that happened, you would have Randall on a long-term deal. That would be pretty catastrophic to the team's long-term future.
I checked the math on this. Sorry, Sean.
There you go.
If you said you can loop both New York teams in a three-team deal that nets you Kyrie Irving, but you have to take back Randall's salary in it, what would you guys do?
So you get Randall and Kyrie.
Correct.
So this is the trade you were texting me about earlier.
Yeah, because we had some back and forth with a Knicks fan about Randall's contract value and what he is as an asset. And so I said, you know what? If the Knicks really want to offload him, the Lakers are reportedly okay taking his long-term salary back. They want Kyrie Irving. The Knicks have some picks. There's a deal that could be there. So I'm just curious, like if that was the cost of getting Kyrie Irving, would you guys do it?
Getting Kyrie, it's a better sell?
Probably. I think I say yes. I think I say, and it's a gamble, but I think that's a gamble that you have to take. I think you'd be pretty certain LeBron signing that extension.
Yeah.
And Kyrie at least gives you the shooting that you need on the floor in order to make Randall work potentially. And then you've got to hope that Randall is at least somewhat closer to his all-star form than he was last season.
Fair enough. I think I do it too, but I don't feel good about it.
If it works, it really works.
Yeah.
Like if it works, it could really be strength, power, all that kind of stuff. And yeah, it could really work. It could also go the other way though too.
I mean, as far as the question goes, I think if, you know, the Brooklyn deal, that aside from that trade I just proposed, doesn't pan out, Indiana doesn't pan out, Utah doesn't pan out, I think the Lakers are desperate enough to move off of Westbrook with Randall.
All I was going to add is that if you trade for Randall and it doesn't work, that's on Pelinka's head more than LeBron's. Even if LeBron and AD are pushing for Randall, that's on Pelinka's head, in my opinion. Because at the end of the day, you're still the general manager. You're still the guy making the final call. And, like, this goes to, like, Ron's point sometimes when he's talking about Rob Pelinka being a bad GM. This literally favors his argument. If Rob pulled the trigger on this and it didn't work,
He's done. But what if Rob doesn't pull the trigger on anything either? And Russ is on the team next season and it goes just like last season. Then he's also done.
What do you always say, Trevor? No trade is better than a bad trade.
True.
It's a bad trade.
I don't know.
I mean, there aren't a lot of good Russell Westbrook trades unless it's like Kyrie and you get to minimize your draft equity you're sending out.
Right. Absolutely. Gotti boy said, Trev, do we want Bron to sign his extension now or should he wait till 2023 and then do something like James Harden, where he says, go spend your money and I'll take whatever's left over? I mean, that would certainly be ideal, but you would also be, LeBron would have to kind of make that known in order to take the pressure off, the heat off of having to hear about that constantly all season long, if that's what he was planning on doing. But that would be the best case situation.
I mean, what does that even look like for him taking less? What is,
It would be, hey, you've got maybe you have THD, maybe you trade him. You've got AD. What does it take to bring in, say, Kyrie as a free agent? what's left over, LeBron gets that.
Fair. Doesn't sound like a lot. You think he goes for that?
Well, I mean, let's say you move THT. Let's say you flip THT for Patrick Beverley, right? So you get an expiring contract. Then what do you have on the books? You've got Damian Jones at a veteran minimum. Then you've got AD. That's it. That's all that's on your books. So you're talking about, what, 40-plus million for AD. You've got some open roster spot charges. Let's say you sign Kyrie and you get him, I don't know what it would be off the top of my head, 40. There's 90 if your cap's at 120. I mean, LeBron would still be taking a pay cut, but it's not like he'd be going down to a veteran minimum or a taxpayer, even a mid-level exception. You could still give him a decent chunk of change there.
I feel like that avenue is only relatively possible depending on what the free agent market looks like. Are we sure Kyrie Irving's going to still want to come to the Lakers next season too?
That's true. And I don't feel any kind of certainty knowing what I don't know what Kyrie's going to want to do next week.
I mean, I literally wrote an article for LakersNation.com like yesterday about how he imagines himself playing in different leagues at the age of 38. I know he's only 30 years old right now, but that just kind of speaks to you just don't know where he's going to end up.
Nice next plug year. There.
It's the site, so I have to.
Quality plug.
We've got Mamba Mentality. Said all signs point no on Randall deal. Forget it was ever a trending topic. Rob, if you see the Knicks on your caller ID, don't answer. Take the battery out of your phone. No deal is better than a bad deal.
How do you take the battery out of your
phone? How do you take the battery out?
Well, there's some phone. If you've got like what I used to be able to do it with Android phones, you could take the battery out.
Rob's got some burners, I guess.
He must.
Yeah.
But just forget it was ever a trending topic. So don't even answer if the Knicks call Rob Pelinka.
Nope.
I've got it at the bottom of the barrel. Like Matt and I were talking. Sean, if you could, let's say you have two options on the table and two options only. And you can either just keep Russell Westbrook or you could trade Russ in a deal that brings back Julius Randle and some salaries like Derrick Rose or something like that. What are you doing?
I'm bringing Russ back. That's the one deal. I'm sorry. That's the one deal where I'm like, yeah, let's just roll for Russ. You could always trade him at the deadline, although I don't think that's the most likely, but you could always trade him at the deadline. And, I mean, it's at least you have some bit of confidence that your head coach is really adamant they could get it to work, too. It sounded like your new head coach is coming here saying, shoot, man, like, there's no chance we're going to get this to work. Just no chance in hell, right? At least your head coach has some confidence. So, like, hey, you know what? Our new coach, he has some faith he could get it to work. This is better than taking on Julius Randle's salary for 4 years. Just keep them. And if you have a deal at the deadline, do it then. Or just roll with this and expiring.
Russ is easier to move at the trade deadline for anyone wondering, just because the Lakers have eaten half his salary at that point. Mm-hmm. So for someone trading for him, let's say it's Indiana or whoever, they would be on the hook for a lot less. So, you know, that's an option.
Shrug.
That would be a lot during the season, but I think, look, if Russ is on the team to start the season, we're going to get trade rumors all the way up until the trade deadline about Russ. That's
going to be a thing.
Isham 976, if LeBron signs a max extension, can the Lakers sign Kyrie outright as a free agent to the supermax he wants? No, you will not have enough under the cap in order to do that. If the Kyrie trade doesn't come through, which trade partners do you prefer, Indiana or Utah?
We had this conversation yesterday on the podcast.
We did. It really depends on who's coming back in a Utah trade. That's the huge differentiator here for me.
Sean, I told Trevor yesterday on the podcast that if the Utah deal is something like Bojan, Malik Beasley, and Patrick Beverley, I'm preferring that over Indiana.
I agree.
Obviously the Indiana deal is still Miles Turner and Buddy Hield, but in this case,
is that your preferred package? Because I know Trevor's for the most part.
I mean, if I could squeeze Jared Vanderbilt, I think that would trump any package, really. But yeah. I'm assuming he's off the table. So, clutch client, Jared Vanderbilt, by the way. if it's something like Mike Conley, Bojan in another piece, I don't know if it's Malik Beasley or if it's someone else, I'm a little less inclined. I'd still maybe prefer it. But my angle here is that the Lakers are getting three players back.
And they need depth.
They need depth. Yep. I like it. I think I prefer that over Indiana as well.
How likely is it you get a more palatable deal, though, from Danny Ainge?
I don't know. Like, see what's
that's the challenge. I'm worried about that.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that the trade costs for both of these deals are the same.
Are the same. Yeah.
Yeah. If I have to give up two firsts to Utah, I'm only going to do that for the first package I mentioned. If it's Mike Conley, probably not.
Yeah. Yeah, that's where it gets tricky. I'm not like, how do you guys feel about Rob Pelinka? We've had this discussion before. Like, how? No, I mean, in context of this though, how comfortable are you with Rob Pelinka negotiating with Danny Ainge and feeling like you're going to come out with a good deal?
Not zero.
Okay, there's a risk factor there, right? That's something you have to consider in terms of these packages. Like, we can say, oh, wouldn't it be great if you could get this from Utah? But it might be that you have a greater probability of getting an actual good deal if you're negotiating with Indiana or something like that than Utah.
Yeah, I mean, like, look, I don't like to bash Rob too much.
Yes, you do.
No, like, okay, hear me out. It's relative to the rest of the league's GMs. It's not so much like, do I think Rob just sucks at his job? It's just, there are a lot of other GMs that I think are doing good work. And I think it should speak to your confidence level in him when you just said you have zero confidence in a negotiation with Danny Ainge. I feel like that should say a lot too. I don't feel good about Rob negotiating in desperate situations like these. I just feel like he's going to have to overpay. And I think, you know, there might be another GM out there that could potentially drive down the cost a little bit. That's just my opinion, though.
No, I agree. That's the one thing that always gets me a little nervous about Rob is trade negotiations. I trust him in free agency a lot, actually. I think his time as an agent really helps bring players in. But trading, no, I have no confidence.
Where do you sit on that, Trevor?
I'm definitely hesitant. Like, how many trades have we looked at them and said, Rob got a good deal there? I think the Dennis Schroeder trade is probably the only one I can think of. And looking back now, that was not a good trade. But at the time, I felt like that was pretty good value. And I think that was the general consensus. That was a good value trade. I don't know what other trades we can look at and say that was a good value. I mean, you could say maybe it was Magic, but obviously the Zubats trade was not a good value trade.
Clarkson and Nance to Cleveland.
Yeah. There was some value there.
Mm-hmm. Offloading Clarkson's contract, getting Isaiah Thomas back, getting a first back.
There's been enough questionable decisions. Allowing Julius Randle to no longer be a restricted. Like, the Lakers never have restricted free agents, basically. And they have one and they just go, wait, it's difficult for you to be a restricted free agent? Then never mind. We don't want that advantage. You know, you can just go be a full free agent. No problem. Stuff like that. Just, we've seen too many mistakes in the margins there for me to feel comfortable.
Yeah. I think it's your favorite analogy. He's missed a lot of singles. Yeah. I think good GMs don't miss on those as often.
But I hope it works.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely.
I hope he hits a home run. Captain Chevrolet, how hilarious would it be if some random team like Atlanta or Sacramento made a Godfather offer for KD? More serious, how do you see as the ideal transition plan for the post-LeBron AD team, AD-led team?
Good question.
Yeah. So what do you think they do? LeBron rides off in the sunset. Let's say it's next summer. LeBron says, I'm out. What do you do?
I got to go revisit the 2023 free agency class, but last time I checked, it's pretty underwhelming. I mean, like, yeah, it's a good question. If LeBron retires, like, how competitive are the Lakers with just Anthony Davis on your roster?
That's why I think a lot of it depends on what we see out of AD this year.
Yep.
Is AD back to being that guy, right? I mean, remember, he hits that shot against the Nuggets, and he's running around the floor screaming, "I'm that guy." That offseason was the last time we saw that guy. Is he going to be that guy again? If he is, then that's a guy that you build around. If he's the guy that we saw these last two seasons and there's no LeBron anymore, he's still really, really good. But I think you have to consider moving on and doing the full teardown. I'm not saying that's definitely the path you choose. I'm just saying it's something you have to consider. Whereas if he looks like that guy again, then you go, okay, AD, we're going to do what we can to build around you. And let's try and win some games here.
One of you two gentlemen remind me, what's the Lakers draft pick situation for 2023 here?
Pick swap.
Okay, so we don't want to tank, but we do get a first. I was going to say, if you can somehow remain semi-competitive in 2023, 2024's free agency class is pretty loaded.
Sweet. I was going to say this. That's why I think the Kyrie... possibly being able to get Kyrie is important as well, not just for the present day time, but post LeBron potentially as well. If you locked Kyrie up, you're building around Kyrie and Anthony Davis instead of Anthony Davis and a bunch of role players with a lackluster free agency class in the middle of that. And also another thing, do you start, let's say you, like Kyrie, for example, either you trade for him, you can't lock him up, or you just can't get Kyrie, and AD gets back to that top 10 player or whatever, but LeBron still retires. Do you consider trading Anthony Davis? Only because his value is at least somewhat closer to what it was when you got him, as it's dropped off the past couple of years.
My answer to that question is always, what am I getting back?
Yeah.
If I got like a godfather offer from another team that thinks they're an Anthony Davis piece away, I'd have to strongly consider it if you're the Lakers, especially since you don't have a lot of draft picks in the next few years here.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. I think you always have to listen in situations like that. I would imagine most Lakers fans are probably not too certain that Anthony Davis can be the rock that you're going to build upon for the future, even though that was the idea when he came in, right? Was that he was going to be the guy that once LeBron starts to ease off, Anthony Davis, he's going to be that guy who's going to come into his own. And we didn't really see it last season. Even when he was healthy, we didn't really see it. And I think that's where some of the frustration with AD comes in. Again, which goes back, it takes us right back to the point where we say this season matters a lot for Anthony Davis and potentially for his Lakers future, because we don't know what LeBron's Lakers future is. But if it's the Anthony Davis of the last 2 years, you have to question whether or not you're going to build around that.
Yeah. I mean, this question could entirely depend on what does the landscape for the rest of the league look like too. Do the Warriors just dramatically fall off? Do Kawhi Leonard and Paul George not stay healthy? If there's a window for the Lakers to compete feasibly, I think they probably keep AD. But like I mentioned earlier, it just depends on what you're getting offered in any deal if they're listening.
Okay. All right. Super Dope Hip Hop. That's a great name.
Love it.
Said, LeBron haters and or Kobe stans who don't accept him have got to stop blaming LeBron when front office ownership said no to Ty Lue, JaVale McGee, Caruso, Lowry, and DeRozan. Are people blaming LeBron? Are you seeing a lot of that, guys?
Yeah.
You're seeing a lot of people saying it's LeBron's fault?
Only really the Lowry, not even Lowry, sorry, just like the DeRozan thing, really. Nothing for the other guys. Those to me felt like front office ownership level moves.
Yeah, I just, when I look at the decisions that they've made, there have been some questionable ones, but I still go back to, it's not just one entity's fault. Everybody shares blame in what happened. Frankly, you don't get to a season as bad as you had if just one person is making mistakes. It takes a lot of people making mistakes to create a situation that was as bad as what we saw last season.
Like, look, I'll say this. If LeBron always got what he wanted, like Alex Caruso would still be a Laker. So I think the front office, namely Rob Pelinka, has some autonomy to make moves on his own. So I can't necessarily blame LeBron for everything, personally.
All right. Let's move on. Let's go to Sammy. Said, I think people say Kyrie has more baggage than he actually does. Unlucky in COVID last year. Thoughts? You're the goats, by the way. Especially you, Matt. Keep it up.
LFG. Your check's in the mail.
So what do we think? Kyrie Irving, does he get a little bit of an unfair rap for having too much baggage?
I think if you ever talk about his on-court stuff, like is he declining or is he just not as good anymore? I think so. I mean, the off-court stuff I think is a legitimate concern. We just don't know, you know, with this whole pandemic thing still going on, do we get another lockdown? Do we get vaccination requirements again? I mean, no one can really say for sure. And then there's just how long does he want to play basketball for? I think that's an open question too. I don't think there's a lot of signs out there, but if Kyrie Irving tweeted out tomorrow, I've decided to retire from the NBA and I'm going to go explore some other interests. Mm-hmm. Like how surprised would you be?
Fair enough.
Yeah. I mean, that could certainly happen, but like how much of last season and therefore the residual effects of that have kind of labeled Kyrie as this guy who was just completely unreliable, how much of that was just COVID, which, you know, is that, and if, perhaps that's not a problem anymore.
I mean, I'd honestly say it's most of it, right? Like okay. The Nets had no problem eventually caving and saying, you know what, you can play road games. Sure.
He still could just decide mid, and we've seen it happen before mid season that he wants a week off. Right.
We've seen it. So it's happened multiple times.
I think there's certainly some baggage there. But if you're the Lakers, you're going to take that.
Oh, speaking of baggage, I will help Kyrie carry lots of it from there.
I will carry Kyrie's baggage because Russ has baggage too.
And I'm helping him carry that to the airport when he gets out. Yes. Grand opening, grand closing, dude. I will drive Russell Westbrook to the airport. Carry his baggages to the terminal, wave him goodbye, and then I'll wait for Kyrie at arrivals.
Get his bags checked and everything.
Dedication. There yep. we go.
I would do it. I'll yeah. do it at 5 p.m. If you're in LA.
Rush hour know. Traffic. Sheesh. Yep.
Oh, man.
I would do it.
Wow. Battling. That is saying a lot. Saying a lot.
There is no greater love language in Southern California than saying, I will drive in rush hour traffic to pick you up from the airport at LAX. There's just.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right. Oh, super dope hip hop is back saying LeBron also didn't draft Lonzo over Tatum, overpaid Dang or Mozgov. Well, there's two different front offices there.
I was going to say, he wasn't even on the team yet.
Right. Like Brooke Lopez and Zubats go for nothing. And Lakers' biggest issue is ownership GM cluster. I mean, I think if you look at just about any ownership group, any front office, you go back, you can find mistakes mm-hmm. if you're looking for them. Now, that said, these were some mistakes that you could say people knew the moment they happened they were mistakes. The Lonzo thing maybe doesn't qualify because I know there were a lot of people who argued very strongly for Lonzo to be the number two pick in that draft. Sure. There were other people who said it should be Tatum. Obviously, looking back now, hindsight being 2020, Tatum was the correct choice. But overpaying Dang and Mozgov, the Brook Lopez thing when he was asking to be brought back,
could have had
Zubats for McCollum. Yeah, those were all things that, as they were happening, people were going, oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, God, no. What are they doing? Right? That was catastrophic moves that everybody could see except for those in the Lakers front office. So I understand pointing to those things. But again, I think you can look at just about any front office out there and you can find mistakes.
Man, Magic as president of basketball ops, not a great record.
That's
understatement.
This is actually something we need to talk about a little bit, though.
Sure.
Should the Lakers, being the Lakers, one of the most valuable sports franchises on the planet, should it be acceptable for the Lakers to make those mistakes, those kinds of mistakes? Or I'm sorry, should it be acceptable for the Lakers to have people running the organization that make those kinds of mistakes?
No.
No.
Right? Because in theory, they should be able to pay whatever the hell they want for the best front office talent.
I agree. I just understand why they don't. I mean, like, look, I get it. Like, they love this perception of being a family business. And I think it's great that they've been able to win as much as they have up to this point. But I mean, let's face it. I just think the landscape requires you to hire smarter, more competent people outside of your inner circle. I feel like the Lakers have been so reluctant to do that. Like even Darvin Ham, who we all loved and I believe is the correct choice for head coach, he had Laker ties.
Mm-hmm. Are we confident that the Lakers hired Darvin Ham if he's had no Laker ties whatsoever?
Probably not, to be super honest.
Yeah, but I think they would have, because Darvin Ham would have them all running through brick walls for him. And as soon as they did that, they would say, okay. Oh, yeah, and they would have hired him.
Okay, sure. Sure. If you believe that, great. I would love to believe that. I just personally don't. Again, it's frustrating to you when you live in the Los Angeles sports market and you see well-run teams like the Dodgers and the Rams doing their thing. And you
and got the Chargers.
Okay, well, win a title first. I'm just saying, like, it's frustrating to see that. Like, I just feel like the Lakers, there's this meme. It's like the Lakers walking into a rake and they just somehow win titles regardless. I just feel like that's so perfect. They just walk backwards into solutions and it just works out. How long feasibly can that happen for?
Like it pains me to say this, but the Clippers front office,
so much more competent,
so much better
than what the, and now part of that too is they've got an owner who will spend. And so Portland says, hey, we've got these salaries, Robert Covington, Norman Powell, and the Clippers went, bring it. No problem. We can pay that. But still, it's a little bit like there's no salary cap for front office personnel. Mm-hmm. There's no salary cap for coaches. There's no luxury tax for those things. You can spend whatever you want on them. If you're not willing to spend on the kind of front office talent that is not going to make those kinds of mistakes, and again, not all of those were from one front office, then what are we doing? And I'm in the side of give Rob Pelinka another shot. I think he did a nice job having a great plan B after Kawhi Leonard said no. I think he made nice moves after winning the championship. I thought the moves that he made were really good. Now, obviously, injuries derailed that team, but I mean, you land the sixth man of the year and the runner up for sixth man of the year, and you add them to the team that just won the championship. Like, you can't complain about that stuff. Last year was not good. So I'm on the side of you give Rob another shot at this. But if this continues on much longer, where you can point to these things and say, man, we're missing a lot of different things in the margins here. We're missing a lot of things where we're just not being creative enough. We're not being forward thinking enough. There's nothing stopping you from going out there and spending whatever you need in order to find the people who are going to make sound decisions in that front office.
To go back to your baseball analogy, it feels like for the better half of the last decade, if not a little bit longer, the Lakers have literally only struck out or hit home runs. No walks, no singles, no the occasional doubles. It's only been that. And I mean, they won a title in that time span, but it's just marginal things that good front offices do that the Lakers just haven't done in the past 10 years.
They're very, very risky gambles that they take. Mm-hmm. I feel like the only consistent thing on their track record is their draft record.
Yes, that's been fantastic.
Outside of that, though, it's like salary cap management, roster development, roster construction, assets. Like, it's just not been good.
And again, you can pay whatever you want, but they still have this mom and pop shop sort of situation. Yeah, it's a concern. We'll see what they do this summer here on the trade front. We'll see what they can do post LeBron, but there's some things that have got to be worked out here before we determine exactly what is Rob, what is this Lakers front office? Because so far, I think overall, there's a lot of mistakes that have been made, and those mistakes have added up to some big problems. And that's part of why the Lakers are in the spot they're at now, where they don't have the assets they need to move off of Russell Westbrook. They don't have the assets they need in order to kind of retool this team on the fly. And part of that is the accumulation of those missed singles that we were talking about. Oh no. The Xbox junkie said Atlanta gets Russ, Wenyan, and a first. Lakers get Bogdan Collins and DeAndre Hunter, the Hawks, before you can even get past John Collins.
Yeah, the Hawks absolutely say no to that.
Yeah, there's no chance that the Hawks would do that.
Look, let me just say, if Atlanta called me, said, hey, we really love Russell Westbrook next to DeJounte Murray and, and Trae Young.
That's the other side of it. Forget about the value, but my goodness, talk about fit.
if Atlanta came calling, I'm gonna assume Travis Schlenk is just super drunk, and he offered that. I am gonna say yes, obviously. But I would bet the house this trade does not happen.
You may be onto something, Matt. Jeannie Buss owns part of a tequila company.
She does. So does LeBron.
LeBron does too. Send samples to GMs around the NBA, and then after those arrive, start making those trade phone calls.
I mean, honestly, the ideal scenario for that to happen would have been during Summer League, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Missed it.
Yeah. Yep. What opportunity. LA has to sit Russ even if we keep him. Wouldn't be a good idea to risk putting Darvin Ham immediately on the hot seat for failing to make him work. I don't think he's going to be.
No, he's committed.
Which is the idea of bringing Russ back.
Darvin Ham has a 4-year contract.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't work, it didn't work last year either. You can't look at that and say, oh, Darvin, your fault. Frank Vogel had great success with Russell Westbrook. Why don't you? That's not the scenario that you're walking into. If anything, it's more likely that he does not have success with him. In fact, I think it's highly, highly likely that he does not have success getting Russell Westbrook to work. And so I don't think it's going to be Darvin Ham on the hot seat. I don't sit Russ unless I know for sure, though, that it won't work. I'm giving Darvin Ham the benefit of the doubt. If Russ stays on the team, I'm giving him a chance. Give Darvin Ham a chance. See if he can get Russ to run through brick walls.
The only thing I'm going to add here is that the Lakers would be incredibly dumb to just put Darvin Ham on the hot seat right after the situation they had with Frank Vogel. That was an absolute PR nightmare, and that was not fun to cover. So I can't imagine themselves doing that again.
That would be like Jim Buss giving himself a deadline.
Yeah,
it would be that level of bad to turn the team back around. And then everybody just went, oh, cool. Thanks for the leverage you just gave us.
Fun times.
Oh, my goodness. Alex Amberling said, any of you guys starting to get that eerie feeling that this is going to be the roster going into next year?
No.
No. I'm not there yet. I'm not willing to accept that at this point.
No, they can't be. There's just no way. Otherwise, we riot.
Like, I have to believe that at some point they're going to move Russell Westbrook.
When push comes to shove, they'll overpay.
The one thing we do know about Rob, he will definitely overpay.
Let's see what else we've got going on. Yeah, I do think that they're going to make some kind of a move. There's been too much chatter about them making a move
for nothing to happen.
Just the question is when. When's it going to happen?
Hopefully soon.
How confident are you that AD can play more than 60 games next season? And what do you do if he can't? Move him. I've got my thoughts on this, but let me get your takes, guys. How likely is it, do you think, AD plays more than 60 games? Like in a percentage. 100% means he is definitely playing more than 60 games. 10% meaning it's probably not happening.
More than 60. Because I think there's going to be built-in rest days for him. There's just no way around it. Ooh, that's like maybe 5, 6, 7 games already off the bat. Damn, if you set the over-under at 59.5, I'd probably lean the under. So I'm going to say it's like 55-45 for me, which sounds like a cop-out answer. But 55, I think he does go over 60.
Well, if you're saying if you set the over-under at 59.5, you're saying you would take the under, then why would you be 55-45 over?
I'm hedging my bet.
You're trying to be optimistic.
Yeah, I'm trying to be optimistic, but man, I don't feel good about it. Yeah, no, I think you're right. I think it's under.
Sean?
I'm hopeful. I'm optimistic that it's over 60, but I can't say I'm have any confidence that it's going to be over 60 as of right now, unfortunately.
Gun to my head, it's under.
Yeah.
I'm going over, and I'm going 75% chance it's over.
Ooh, there we go. Give me some optimism. And
here's why. I'm going to go back to the fact that last season I felt both of the injuries that occurred that cost him the majority of the games were fluke things. Guy falls into his knee, lands on Rudy Gobert's foot. I am hopeful that The math is going to catch up at some point. We're going to see positive regression to the mean here. Drink. And Anthony Davis will not have that kind of fluke injury that robs him of like half of the season. And we will see him. And again, I think he knows how important the season is to him as well. And I do think the Lakers' efforts to try to keep him healthy will also help the situation. So I am going to go into the season optimistic. I am going to speak it into existence that we're going to see Anthony Davis for more than 60 games.
I mean, if you look at his career logs, technically the trend says he will play over 60, or at least the math says he plays over 60 more. I hope you're right. I would love to watch Anthony Davis play more basketball.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Yeah, I mean, that's really, you know what? We need to talk about that real quick. Because I've got so many people out there that are saying that I see, particularly like Russ stands, right? Saying, I hope Russ balls out next season and plays for the Lakers and he's great. And then where's everybody going to be? I'll be celebrating.
Obvious jersey right next like, to AD's jersey.
That would be fantastic. I would love to be wrong about that. We've been saying pretty much all summer that you need to move Russell Westbrook, right? If they don't move him, we'll be saying that was a mistake. If they don't move him and somehow Darvin Ham makes it work, somehow Russell Westbrook refines his shooting touch again, somehow he looks like his old self and things start clicking. Oh my gosh, that would be incredible. That would be amazing. That would give us the chance to tell the story that we wanted to tell about Russell Westbrook coming back to LA. That's not something where people will be going, man, I really wanted Russell Westbrook to be terrible because that's what I was expecting to happen over the summer. No, we want to see the Lakers do well. That's not what it's going to be. And it's funny, I see that argument with a lot of different players. I'm like, wait, that would be fantastic. That would be wonderful.
Just don't get it, man.
There's no victory lap there. I will be running the lap with you.
Yeah, literally.
Right, yeah, absolutely.
Joan Oliva said, you get one wish granted. AD becomes immune to injury. Trade Russ for Kyrie instantly or make LeBron 10 years younger.
Make LeBron 10 years younger.
Make LeBron 10 years younger.
I think that's the easiest answer. Yep.
Has to be. You get another 10 years of LeBron. And I mean, what? LeBron at 27 is a destroyer of worlds who can, you know.
MVP.
Yeah. Like Russ and LeBron might actually work if LeBron is 27-year-old LeBron, just because LeBron would be that ridiculous.
Well, look at it from like this. There's so many angles you can look at this from. The Lakers have LeBron and AD basically on the same timeline. That's mm-hmm. one.
That's one.
Two, yeah. Let's say Anthony Davis cannot stay on the floor. You can eventually trade him and reload against around LeBron. I mean, basically the story here is that you can build a contender for the foreseeable future if LeBron's 10 years younger.
Mm-hmm.
You've got options.
And 27-year-old LeBron was still at the point where you, me, Trevor, and Ron as his supporting cast, you're still winning 50 games. That's how good LeBron was at 27.
You know, coincidentally, 10 years ago, this is like when he wins like his second title. So yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, you're definitely doing that. You're definitely doing that. Esham 976, Kyrie's so flaky. Do you give him a clean max?
That's a great question.
So yeah. Let's say the Lakers do trade for Kyrie, and his contract expires, but you picked up his bird rights because he picked up his option. So now you've got bird rights on him. You can pay to go over the cap. Let's say LeBron extends. You trade Russ. You trade two firsts. You get Kyrie. What are you giving him the full 4-year max that he wanted from the Nets, and the Nets wouldn't give it to him? Are you putting in some kind of protections like we've seen with Joel Embiid, like we've seen now with Zion Williamson? How are you handling that contract if you're the Lakers?
I'm going to probably offer a 2-for-1. I'd give him a player option the last year, but that last year is going to have some protections on it as far as games played.
Okay.
I think that's how I'd approach it if I'm the Lakers. Obviously, I think that's kind of why the talks with Brooklyn broke down, is because they were trying to do the same thing, and he said, no, I want a full max. So that's what I'm coming with the Lakers. The other part of this equation is LeBron. How many more years am I confident he's staying with the Lakers? If I could tie him to Kyrie Irving's length contract, I would probably consider that as well.
Yep, that's it exactly. Now, Kyrie might not want to take that kind of contract. So that's where you're going to have to negotiate and you have to figure out exactly. I mean, look, he didn't want the contract the Nets were offering.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to have to kind of walk that fine line. But I'd much rather be in that scenario where maybe things are a little uncomfortable with Kyrie next summer trying to figure out the right contract than the situation the Lakers are in right now.
Yeah, I agree. Just get the guy on the door.
Alan says he will chip in for gas if you're driving through that LA traffic. Matt.
No tips necessary. Appreciate it. I'm just doing my part to make sure we get the right point guard on the floor. So
if AD is injured, let's say he misses 40 games next season. What do you do with him?
I mean, I think you just have to keep him because his value is just going to tank lower. You're not going to get anything equal value for him, right?
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably. So, I mean, there's a lot riding on this.
That's just making me sad.
But do you commit and go all in to building a team around him? If that's
depends. Is LeBron still on my roster?
Let's say LeBron says, "Nah, I'm out."
No.
Okay, I think the way I would do this is I would try to just stack a lot of medium level contracts. That way I can turn it into a trade down the line here.
Yep. That is probably the way to do it.
Right. Yeah, like you don't chase the other star. You bide your time until maybe free agency or if someone else wants to ask out, and then that's when you swoop in. Because that's the thing, right? Like the Lakers just don't have a lot of tradable contracts on their roster.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This is assuming no LeBron, no Kyrie, so you've got a pretty clean book. Just sign a bunch of 2-3 year deals with guys for like 15, 20 million. That way you can move them later.
Like AD has 2 more years under contract. 1 more year after this season, the 2022-2023 season, he has 1 more year under contract and then a player option for the next season. If he's injury prone this season and the offers aren't great, you probably do run it back 1 more year. But again, you don't necessarily, you try to find short-term contracts so you have flexibility for that year that he has a player option, and then you figure out what you're going to do from there.
Mm-hmm.
Keon said, the only thing I don't like after LeBron coming to the Lakers was the Lakers trading Brandon Ingram instead of Kyle Kuzma in the AD trade. BI could have been the real third option and even a second option if and when LeBron doesn't play for the Lakers anymore. I don't think that was ever on the table. I don't think the Lakers ever had the choice of, well, pick one, Kuzma or Brandon. For some reason, that's been out there for a while. Like the Lakers chose to send out Ingram instead of Kuzma, which their salaries weren't very close. And that doesn't make any sense from the Pelican side, why they would be okay with Brandon Ingram not being in the deal over Kyle Kuzma.
No, I mean, if I remember correctly, it's really more Kyle Kuzma or you throw in more picks.
Right.
So if you're mad at Rob for throwing in an extra first and maybe a swap, it's probably because he really wanted to keep Kuz. If I'm New Orleans, I'm not saying yes to any Anthony Davis deal unless I get Brandon Ingram back. So
yeah,
I sincerely doubt
that was the main piece.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he would be the main piece in a Kevin Durant deal if that was on the table. It's not like Brooklyn's gonna say, yeah, you know what, give us like Herb Jones or something and some picks and we'll call it a day. Like it has to be Brandon Ingram at that
deal. Jones is great, but yes, you're right.
He's great. I love Herb. Not on Herb.
Somebody using my name said, rewatch the 2012 Olympics. Well, that was 10 years ago. That's a decade ago.
That's right.
Russ pressured the ball well because of his athleticism, but he was never a good defender. I've come to terms with Russ.
That's the Russ that Darvin Ham wants.
And that's the problem, though, is what are your chances of getting that? Because that's what Darvin Ham is asking him to be. What are your chances that he can become what Darvin Ham wants him to be?
See, this is my whole thing with Russ. This is like my working theory is that he is not going to do those things unless he is very clearly down on the totem pole as far as players. So when you compare him to Team USA, when you've got Kobe, Kevin Durant, LeBron, Chris Paul, all these guys, it's a lot feasible to go to Russ and say, look, these are the guys we have. We need you to do these things versus you're our third best guy, but we still need you to do these things. That's a harder conversation to have.
Mm-hmm.
100%. Yep. And I don't know if you're going to get him to buy in and do all that stuff with that factored in. Vector Nova, Kyrie's baggage is the thing that makes me nervous about locking him up post-LeBron. With LeBron here, my concerns are elated. if he's gone, I'm looking for the draft to potential for a potential co-star with AD. So the concern here, and this is not is something that I haven't heard before, that essentially if LeBron is on the Lakers, Kyrie's going to be on his best behavior. LeBron's going to kind of keep him in check. If LeBron rides off into the sunset and says, I'm going to retire, I'm going to go play with Bronny, whatever it is, and he's no longer there, suddenly you're going to get a Kyrie that doesn't do the things that you need him to do, that he's going to be misbehaving, essentially. Do you guys buy that?
I don't know. What do you think, Sean?
I just find it weird. I think if this is – I'm a little skeptical that LeBron is 100% going to be able to get Kyrie beyond his best behavior or whatever. Like, he's 30. Like, if he's acting this way in other places – I mean, I get it. We saw the best version of Kyrie with LeBron. But, like, the whole notion to be on his best behavior or whatever, I don't buy it. And then – I'm a little nervous about, like, if your plan is, like, going through the draft or potential co-star for Anthony Davis, are we going to be bad enough to get that, one? And two, are we going to have our pick? Or are the Pelicans going to say, for example, 2024, no, we'll take this top 10 pick because you were that bad. You could keep 2025.
So, and who's to say a rookie is going to be good enough to give AD exactly. the boost that he needs?
They're going to be on completely different timelines.
Yep, exactly. That's the problem. That's the problem. That's the problem. Super Dope Hip Hop, again, coming in, said, saying this as a Pacers season ticket diehard since the 80s, who has a cheap owner. He does facepalm emoji. Every team is only as great as their ownership / GM. You guys know your stuff. Props. Oh, thank you. I really do appreciate that. I mean, ownership is the best, is the greatest competitive advantage in the NBA.
Tells money.
Right,
which I guess is tied to ownership, but yeah, I agree.
Yeah, that's really what it comes down to. So, I don't feel as good about all of that stuff as I did a few years ago. Certainly as I did a decade ago with the Lakers.
Not to jump too far ahead, but let's just say Rob gets canned after this season because it just doesn't work out. Like, how confident are you the Lakers hire someone not within the family, quote unquote?
Not very. Because what they've historically shown us that's what they'll do. So until they do something different, why would we project them to do that? You know what I mean? Like, what? That's the pattern that they've always had. I mean, I'm going to assume that the pattern is going to continue until it doesn't.
You know who would have been a cool option? Ryan West.
Where is he now?
Great question. I thought he followed his dad, but could be wrong.
The Clippers?
I'm going to double check, but I just think that pro personal scout Detroit Pistons. Okay.
Oh, he's over the Pistons now?
That is Ryan West 79, if that's him on the old Instagram, then I believe so.
Yeah, he's with the Pistons.
Yeah. I think that it's – look, if things don't work out here with Rob – I think it's time for new voices. I don't have a lot of confidence we're going to see that, though.
Same. I don't know, man. Like, it's the more I look at other teams around the league and even in other sports, you just realize that how much of a disadvantage the Lakers are. Like, just imagine if LeBron doesn't want to come to the Lakers in 2018. Like, where is this franchise right now?
I mean, you've got Brandon Ingram on extension. You've got Lonzo. You've got those. You've got the young guys. And then whatever deals that you made in the meantime.
Like, if you just had all the Lakers kids, like, realistically, what kind of team are you looking at, though?
Play-in team? Middle of the pack? Play-in, maybe low-level playoff team?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So this is what I was saying. The Lakers just fall backwards into solutions.
Sometimes they do.
Yep.
Sometimes they do. And again, I'm hoping this changes. I'm hoping they find a way. I'm hoping that the patience this summer pays off, and sometime before training camp, they find the right deal and the Lakers look better next season and it's an enjoyable season and that changes the narrative. Because let's face it, the narrative heading into the championship season was, oh my gosh, this is the worst front office ever. Yeah. Right? That was it. People kept talking about how dumb the Lakers are. That was the conversation.
There's a whole compilation of it.
That changed everything.
Yeah. There's a whole compilation of it.
Yeah.
That 2019 offseason was just nothing about the Lakers suck. What are they doing? This roster is terrible. Overpaid for Anthony Davis. The Clippers are going to be champions. Whole thing. And isn't it funny? Because that's what we're kind of talking about this summer too.
Yep. We're right back at it again. Mike E., what's more valuable, a so-so rush trade that doesn't get you over the top or keeping your picks and using the $47 million expiring deal? I'm assuming that means keep the picks and the $47 million expiring deal, and then you go into next season with the picks, that money off your books, all that.
If it means you're trading for Julius Randle, I'm assuming that's what we're talking about here with the so-so rush trade.
That's not a so-so rush trade.
No.
That's a bad rush trade.
The problem is LeBron, right?
At some point, Rob has to man up, I guess. I don't know. You don't. Yeah.
Byron Scott, PTSD.
You got to be in the foxhole.
You got to just man up.
I'm sorry.
I think if LeBron was not on this team right now, you could make an argument for doing this. You don't pay any assets to get rid of Russ. You keep those assets. Oh, you let Russ expire. Maybe you use him as an expiring contract at the trade deadline, but not something where you're going to have to pay a bunch of stuff just to move his contract. And then you head into next season with all the picks that you have, and you build from there and all the cap space. But you do have LeBron, and it's a good thing that you've got LeBron. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. It's a good thing that you've got LeBron, but it complicates the situation because LeBron doesn't have a season to sit around and wait for Russell Westbrook's contract to fall off the books.
Look, if the Knicks is the only outcome I do this deal, if the Knicks give us draft compensation, sure, do it. But I'm damn sure not doing it if I'm giving up draft compensation. Then it's a hard sell if it's, you know, no compensation given at all. It's just Russ for Fournier and Randle, for example. But yeah, but what Matt just did there.
Wretch.
We talked about this. We talked about that yesterday, Sean. I want to ask you, what do the Knicks need to give you for you to take on Randle? And if they throw in Fournier especially, what do they need to give you to get that?
At least one first, if not two.
That's funny because some people would tell you that the Lakers would need to give up picks in that situation.
You're drunk.
There's people who believe that if Russell Westbrook is leaving the Lakers, automatically that means two picks are on the way out the door. Now again, that's a lot of haterade out there.
Good luck to the Knicks if they are serious about dumping Randle's contract at any point.
I don't even know that they should be that.
I don't think they would. I'm just saying if they were like motivated to move off money for whatever reason.
Like they're in win now mode. I don't think the Knicks should be in the business of trying to dump Randle right now. I think the Knicks should be trying to hang on to Randle right now. And then if he turns things around, maybe you can look to move out off that money next season. I don't see what the urgency is to move off of Randle's contract at the moment from the Knicks side. I would just hang on to him if I'm them, unless I can somehow get something. And that's where, like, if they're looking at the Lakers going, hey, maybe we can move Randle and get a first. But if I'm the Lakers, I would be expecting draft compensation for taking on Randle.
I love this question.
Sorry, before we get to that, quick question. Before we get back to that, but to go back to the Rob Pelinka thing, do you think teams or like rival fans think we have to give up two first because their GM is Rob Pelinka and they know that Rob will overpay more times than not?
I think it's just it's the Lakers.
Yeah.
I think Rob factors in it, but I think it's just because it's the Lakers.
It's the Lakers, and they don't want to see. I've seen so many times people use the phrase, don't bail the Lakers out. There's this
desperation. Pau Gasol trauma.
Yeah, they do not want to see any team allow Russell Westbrook to leave the Lakers because they see Russell Westbrook as the thing that will stop the Lakers this season. And so they don't want him being moved. So you're seeing that around. They want something extremely damaging to happen to the Lakers if Russell Westbrook is being moved. But that's, again, that's fandom for other teams. So shout out to my fellow Long Beach State alumni question.
That's right.
I believe trading for depth pieces and a healthy AD can bring us back to contention by THT.
Hashtag go beach.
Yeah. So depth trading for depth pieces, that would be the Utah trade.
Yep. Agree. Right. Partially the Indiana deal too, but I think that if you can get more rotation guys back in a deal, I think that should be the Lakers' preference if it's not Kyrie Irving.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Bernie, I choose option four, give myself 10 years of youth.
I don't know, man. I'm not trying to go back to prom, bro.
Option five, giving myself 10 years of youth. I'm 45, man. I got to go down a little bit.
For anyone that missed the podcast yesterday, go check it out. You can get a tidbit from my young days.
Matt had a great prom story. You guys, I heard the full version, too, after the show.
It just gets better, doesn't it?
It gets better.
What did I miss?
Don't worry. You should go listen to the podcast.
Are you telling us that you don't listen to the show?
You just had a flight, Sean.
Next question. We're
busted.
Busted.
Dustin Daniel, Russ trade. You think is most likely Indy, Brooklyn, or Utah?
It depends.
I'm still gonna say Indy.
Brooklyn. You gonna say Indy?
Most likely Indy. That's the one I want.
I could see the argument for that.
I will go Brooklyn. I think they've been talking for too long.
Bronny on the South Bay Lakers would be fun.
It would be.
It would be fun. But I think wherever he goes, I mean, since LeBron's going to be there, he'll be like, it's not, you know, hey, LeBron's going to be playing with the main club and Bronny is not there because he's with the G League team.
He'll get a call up.
That defeats the purpose for LeBron. I should be the GM. I got a 43-year-old Bron with 9 rings on 2K. Can't be any worse than what we've got.
I love it.
There you go. Sorry if it's been answered. Just hopping on. What do you think the cutoff is on a Kyrie trade? Jovan Buha said the Russ offer gets better over time, but he also mentioned the trade deadline is halfway through. I think Jovan is right that that Russ becomes more appealing later on in the season when you've paid more of his salary. But a cutoff for a Kyrie trade, I mean, realistically, the trade deadline would be kind of the cutoff, you know. But the Lakers ideally would like to get it done before training camp.
So I'd say so.
At mid-September, like third week of September is probably what we're looking at.
Would you say it would be the 21st night of September?
Would I say it'd be what?
The 21st night of September.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess the Earth, Wind, and Fire reference just
never mind. Yeah. Didn't get that one at all.
Sorry, it's my jam. I think there's an internal trade deadline before training camp. I think that's what we're all operating under. Like, I think Brooklyn and the Lakers would like to avoid the situation. Thanks, Sean, for laughing. I appreciate it. I thought it was funny.
I'm laughing at Trevor's reaction.
I can't believe this. Out of all the outdated references, and this is the one you don't get?
That's the one I didn't get.
I'm going to have to look up when September came out because I'm pretty sure.
There wasn't. So in my house growing up, we were very much a KLOS family, which means it was like more the heavier rock. That's what we were brought up on.
That's fair. This is the stuff I grew up listening to in my mom's car. So 1978, for anyone that was wondering, by the way.
There you go.
Right around the time I was born. So yeah, makes sense.
Vector Nova, on the draft, do you guys make the player selected with the pick swap in the 2023 draft available for trade if LeBron stays? Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. You can move that guy as soon as you make the pick.
DeAndre Hunter.
Yeah.
Yep. That is still the dumbest thing about NBA draft is that
they
get traded and they still have, like, I like it that the NFL, when you trade picks, you can just say the team that drafted them.
Right. Yeah, the guy putting on the wrong hat and everything.
Yeah, like DeAndre Hunter with the Lakers hat is still on the internet. Anthony Davis trade.
Yep. Mama mentality. Does Rob have full control on picks attached to Russ at the trade deadline?
Like, does he have the authority to trade all of them?
Yeah.
Say so.
I think I would believe so. If it means making a title run, yeah. Giorgio Guerra said, as a Yankees fan, I was spoiled by our front office before the trade deadline. This also made me sad because our Lakers front office is not. The Rambi need to step up and take charge.
Yankees did kill it.
For the Yankees.
The Yankees have been killing it.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's okay. The Dodgers could end up with Juan Soto in like 12 hours, so it's fine.
Or Ian Happ. I'll take him too.
When is the MLB? When's the actual deadline?
3 p.m. Pacific, I think.
Yeah, tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah, it's tomorrow. So that's why you're hearing all this noise.
Right,
Juan Soto got a large ovation tonight because I think a lot of people realize it is his last game.
He got a couple hugs in the dugout too, didn't he?
I think so. So, yeah. Sorry. As far as this question goes, yes. Congrats. If you're a Yankees fan, you guys are killing it. Good deadline to you. The Lakers front office has been basically the opposite, not spending money and not trading for stuff.
Yeah. Yep. Hope again. I'm holding out hope that patience indeed pays and that the Lakers being patient ultimately leads them to the right deal before training camp. I would have liked it to have already been done, but I'm hoping that the trade-off is we see the right deal get done and they head into training camp with a much improved roster.
It's going to happen on your vacation, dude. Just pencil it.
Oh, jeez. Yeah. I am fully expecting that. I'm fully expecting that. I am going to be doing some type of video from the beach.
What a flex. Yeah,
that's going to have to happen.
Sorry, guys. The internet keeps cutting out. I'm at the beach with this nice view and weather.
That's right. That's going to be a thing. That's going to be a thing. No, it'll be Matt the Optimus Peralta or Sean Spaces Davis will be in there breaking down Kyrie to the Lakers. And I'll just be watching it from the beach. I'll be going, nice job, guys. Well done.
Well, I don't know. I mean, hopefully Sean's there. Might be in spaces somewhere.
Matt, yeah, you'll have to break him out of a space somewhere.
I will. Sean, what are the odds that you're going to be on one like 10 minutes after we hop off here?
I bet the house on it.
All right, then. You know, someone told me we should change your nickname, and I said it's entirely up to Sean.
To what? Sean Film Breakdown Davis since Lonnie Walker's finally done? Yay.
Congrats. What a long-running joke. It's like the Lost Tapes.
That's right.
The Lost Breakdown.
We were talking about that for so long. Where is the Lonnie Walker breakdown?
Throw it into the ether.
Yeah.
Oh, good.
All right, everybody. Let's wrap things up so Sean can get over to spaces. Appreciate everybody who joined us live from YouTube, from Facebook, from Twitter. Throw us all kinds of questions to get into. Remember, we're going to be doing 3 days a week now, Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Won't have the standalone podcast on the in-between days until we get back towards the regular season. So we'll restart 5 days a week sometime mid-September. Till next time, everybody. See ya and stay safe.